to another episode of Music Girl Hideout, the show where we hang out with artists, musicians, and entertainers in Waylon Jennings' old basement studio. My name is Jerry, and as always, I'm gathered here with co-host Ryan Poole. Well, I'll pass it to you to introduce our guest.
Well, tonight, on a very special episode of Music Row Hideout, we have the one and only Nickolas Wheeler.
Hello.
Went the long version there.
I try to time it because
that was great. With that, and you didn't even have like the countdown, like the like radio DJs get.
No. They get a countdown.
I think so. Like because you know how they always talk right up until the vocal starts.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, they have like a little countdown for that. And first try, by the way, you nailed it.
Yeah, I feel like I did good. Didn't miss any words. A lot of times I forget to say my name. You know, it happens over time.
I clearly just forgot my name because it took me 7 seconds to respond there. Hi. Thanks for having me.
Well, I usually try to let that thing like run out and time that just kind of.
You did great. You guys are doing great.
Thank you.
Wow. Absolutely crushing it today.
No, I think I said Nickolas Wheeler. Right before I was like Nickolas or Nick. You're Nickolas on Instagram, but do you go by Nick?
On paper, I'm Nickolas. I don't know why. It's just like once I had to have an email signature, I made it my full name. And it's not the typical spelling either, so that's a fucking nightmare. But
is that like a K in it or something?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah. That's no rough. H.
No H.
No H.
Okay, it's like an Eastern European style or something, right?
I don't know. I did the 23andMe. I'm just basic white guy, so I don't know where
classic
it comes
white
from. Yeah.
Fair enough.
Awesome. I have nothing else to say.
That's your whole intro, huh?
No, sweet. I was
good
really
show,
wanting
guys
to rattle on that basic white. I was enjoying that. Nick, can I call you Nick?
Yes,
please. You never
please
answered
do
my question.
Nickolas is weird. Read my name the other way, but when you talk to me, just say Nick. It's weird otherwise.
Yeah. So Nick is a producer, an engineer here in Nashville, Tennessee, and also guitar player for a band that I once upon a time really, really loved. And by the way, never stopped loving
him. Okay, why do you hate him now?
Oh, wow.
Wow.
What happened?
That's a really aggressive way to start this episode.
Did I offend you?
I'm here to confront you on that. No, Nick plays guitar in the All-American Rejects. And I want to take you back. The year,
take me back.
Yeah. The year was 2002. And as we all remember, my dad was driving
a white F-150.
Oh, yeah. Just the other day.
Yeah. Just the other day.
And we were driving to school, listening to rock radio, and the weirdest thing happened. A fucking organ started playing. and it went something like this.
Oh, are you having queued up? Wow.
Yeah. I wasn't planning on this. I'm improvising, okay?
Okay.
And this organ happened.
Just
I'm like, what the hell is an organ doing on rock radio? Are we at a funeral? Are
yes
we at a dirge?
Yes.
And then, oh, there's a little guitar. Is that you, by the way?
Mm-hmm. That's like four of me.
Oh, shit. And then the song comes in. This is take longer than I hoped.
Oh, yeah. It was 2002. You could have a 20-second intro. See, and this would be where the radio DJ's talking. They have like a whole minute to bullshit until the vocal finally starts.
Wesley, I'm going to need you to get us a talking timer. All right.
We didn't know that was an option.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Sorry, dude.
But yeah, so the song comes on and and so the song Swing Swing by the All-American Rejects. And it moved my heart.
Aww.
Nick, I got to tell you. I was probably like 15, and so
I wasn't much older.
Yeah, which is...
I swear.
Which is like crazy looking back, because I think you think like all your favorite bands are like, they're adults.
Right.
And, like, and we're kids. But like the age differences are so...
I'm still not an adult.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Was that something like a 5-year age difference? 6, maybe?
Yeah, I think I was 19 when that came out.
Yeah. Dude. Wild. Yeah. So not that different. It's wild.
So, like, when that came out, so from my perspective as a 15-year-old, and I was, like, super, we're both from San Diego. Actually, all three of us are.
Oh, nice.
And so.
I was going to ask where you grew up, if you're riding in your dad's F-150. I had a totally different picture in my
yeah
mind where you grew up.
Yeah, nah, my dad's kind of a redneck, but we,
okay, got
we
it
lived in San Diego. And for me, I was like super into the pop punk scene at the time. And that song came on, loved it, felt a lot of emotions I didn't know I had yet. And I forgot what I was trying to say.
You were having some kind of awakening, it sounds like.
I was having an awakening. And I think, like, me and my friends at school were like, I feel like the All-American Rejects was the first band I heard called emo.
Interesting.
Right, which is interesting because I think, like, a lot of people would say, like, Clarity back in 99 was more like one of the early emo records. Mm. But then even before that...
We were definitely inspired by Clarity. Like I was saying earlier, that was my record in high school for sure. That and Something to Write Home About. Get Up Kids.
Oh. Ish. A little bit before my time, the Get Up Kids.
But this was like the 1900s.
Yeah.
Just about.
Yeah.
Yeah, back when we were all driving horse-drawn carriages. But yeah, so from my perspective at that time, I was like, a band is on the radio. Okay, I guess you're like a big time famous person and like making millions of dollars.
That's exactly the trajectory. Yeah.
So like, bring me back to 2002, because back then you were a 19-year-old. If I saw you on the street today, I'd be like, that's a little kid.
Yeah.
What was that like getting your song out there? Like, were you like, we're fucking famous?
It's kind of a trip because we grew up in Oklahoma. Tyson, our singer, and me wrote a handful of songs, and we made a demo at my house on my little Tascam. And, you know, I think I'd graduated from the Tascam. I was on Cakewalk at this point on my on my Dell. I bought myself a Dell. All right, you're at least old enough to get that.
Like, the marketing got to you.
Yeah.
Dude, got a Dell. Bro, my first computer, like, for Pro Tools that I was, like, really going to go for it was a Dell.
Hell yeah.
Got my grandma to buy me a Dell. So stoked. Turns out most Dell chipsets don't work with Pro Tools.
And Pro Tools didn't work on Windows for quite a while.
Dude.
It still barely does.
It's a real tragedy. So, I went Mac.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. I eventually, 5 years later, I got my first Mac. But yeah, I was on Cakewalk 8, I think. It looked like early Pro Tools, but kind of looked like Minesweeper. So then I burned a bunch of CDs, went down to Kinko's. Now FedEx office, used to be called Kinko's.
Does Kinko's not exist anymore?
I still call it Kinko's.
I mean, FedEx Kinko's, and now it's FedEx.
I didn't even have any idea that was the case. I'm not up to date on my
We can
copy
look it up.
War.
He said we can bring up Wikipedia.
That's true. No, well, Wesley, can we go?
excuse me. But went to Kinko's and cut out the inserts with their paper cutter. And sold them at our shows, and then I ended up taking those CDs, a couple of them that we just referenced. And if you flipped over a CD, you could get the...
You brought it up.
Brought it up.
Yeah. See, you used to say FedEx Kinko's.
Oh, you're right.
Yeah.
You're right. That's just
Kinko's
wild.
Kinko's was so 90s, by the way.
Like, oh, yeah. Well, before even FedEx got involved, it was just Kinko's.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah, I remember that. Like, I didn't know it was ever anything
watching friends
that.
And saying yada yada and going to Kinko's to make copies with drinking some Java. Like, that was a day in the 90s.
Weird. I don't know if I care about that.
Now you're just making up words.
Java.
But I flip over a CD and look at the record label address on there and just... write on a bunch of padded envelopes, stuff them, and mail them off unsolicited. And thanks to the Get Up Kids, Doghouse Records actually opened it and listened to it. And they flew out to Tulsa and signed us on those 5 songs that we had. And then they were like, okay, like, we can make a record whenever y'all are ready. We're like, we just have 5 songs. So our singer had to finish up high school early. He had one semester left. We're like, okay, we got one semester to write the rest of this fucking album.
And what did you have at the time?
I mean, there were all songs that made the album, but we didn't have Swing Swing. We didn't have The Last Song. We didn't have My Paper Heart. Didn't have Time Stand Still. I think we had like Your Star, maybe some of the side B shit. None of the singles though. Those all came like literally the 11th hour, you know, as they usually do, I feel. I would sleep in because I was fucking 18 or whatever at the time.
I'm still sleeping in.
Really?
You're in good company.
Man, I wake up every day between 7:30 and 8, and
no
I can't sleep later than that. Even if, like, last night I was up later than usual, still just woke up at fucking 7:30. It's the pits, man.
Oh, I have to be at work at 8, which is at my house. And it's really, really tough for me to show up on time. Like, it's hard.
Dude, I get that, man. Anything that you have to, like, schedule, like, it's... sorry. That could be a tangent. But yeah, so I would sleep in. I would go get some Java.
Yeah. Hell yeah.
Yeah. It was the early 2000s. We were still saying Java. You know, then I would go to the P.O. box to see if the band got any mail.
Say.
We never did. And then I would go home and I would just like start like building like tracks and like putting down guitar parts for songs we were working on. And then when Tyson got out of school around 3 o'clock or whatever, he would come over. He might record some vocals on one of these demos, or we would write another song, or, you know, we would just work on music for a few hours. And we did that for that whole semester. And then after Christmas, we took all the cash we had. I think collectively was like $600 or something. We got in our band van, which was a 1993 GMC Rally or something. It barely got us to like Dallas in Kansas City, but we thought we would just drive it to New York City to record our record with Tim O'Hare.
Yeah, no problem.
Yeah, it made it. It made it there and back. No problems. We did, this was before GPS though. Somehow we got off, you know, this was back when you had to print out MapQuest directions.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
I was going to say.
Thomas Guide under the seat.
I didn't know about the Thomas Guide.
Ooh, but that's the high tech version.
Okay. I just did MapQuest, printed at home, not Kinko's. But if you take a detour or you like want a pit stop, your MapQuest directions are fucking useless. So I think we made it to New York and back by using a Cracker Barrel U.S. map that just had it had all of the interstates and it showed where like all the Cracker Barrel locations were.
Yeah.
And so that was how we made it.
Did you eat at more than a normal amount of Cracker Barrels on that trip?
I mean, of course.
I'm on a road trip. I don't know if there is an amount that is too high to be a normal amount of Cracker Barrel on a road trip.
I don't even know where I was going with this or what the question was. I'm
yeah,
just kind of
matter. We just talk.
Starting at the beginning.
Tell me about, okay.
So we spend 2 months in New York in a real studio recording on like a vintage Neve console.
Nice. What was the studio called?
It was Mission Sound did the basic tracks. And that's like I think they're still kicking and they're doing great. Like it's a legit awesome studio. I think they were still in the beginning stages when we recorded there, or at least it seemed that way. They did have a cool tape machine. I think it was a Studer. I don't remember. But I do remember the vintage Neve console. I remember a nice, large tracking room. I cut the drums in there. I did a bunch of rhythm guitars.
Tyson, so you were the drummer?
I played drums on the first album, yeah, because just me and Tyson.
Oh, wow.
Well, a lot of the drums were programmed, and that might have been part of it. But it was also like late 90s, early 2000s, like a lot of that kind of drum loops, but with live drums on top of it too, kind of thing.
Right. Well, I remembered last night I went and I listened back through your first album.
Oh shit, I need to do that sometime.
And I was like, okay, time to remember. Okay.
Yeah.
So I listened through and I started having memories come back to me. And one of them was, oh yeah, we all thought there's electronic drums on this. This is different. Like, what's up, you know, because, again, like, very pop punk at that time.
Right.
It was like, what's this pop punk band doing with electric drums? This is crazy. But then as I listened to it, I'm like, okay, that's barely any electronic drums.
Okay,
like,
sweet.
It's very subtle. Like, it was like my paper heart. Like,
yeah, they were all, most of them were like 909 samples coming off of a Korg Triton.
Okay, nice.
That was what all of that shit was. All the programming, all the sequencing, all the strings, all the organ. That's all. That's all the Korg Triton.
Like everything I'm saying, it's like in the same direction of how much times have changed.
Yeah.
That at that time, from like this rock mentality where we had just been, our whole growing up was like 90s rock. Like rock had been in for a while, and there was like you have new rock and old rock.
Yep.
So the subtle digital elements or having an organ, that was really novel to me at the time. Is like, this is so different. But listening to it now, I'm like, we've gone so far down the EDM rabbit hole. I listen to it now, I'm like, oh no, this is rock. They just had of course you could have a little sample in it.
Right. And now it's just like whatever the fuck you want. Like,
oh, yeah.
You know, the whole like genre doesn't matter thing. It's just like, let's make a song like this with these elements. And like, you can just fucking pull up Logic or whatever and find a sample of that. It's kind of silly how easy that is now, but
yeah,
I had to buy a Korg Triton because we wanted a string section on some songs and we wanted drum loops and shit. And like I said, I don't know if that came from us not having a drummer when we played live. It was just me and Tyson playing with a drum machine. And yeah, I programmed some live drums, but also I was like, live drums sound funny coming off my Korg Triton, so maybe I'll just make them more loopy. I don't know if that's where it came from or if it was just, you know, us trying to be more experimental and more poppy, because we were trying to get on the radio and get the fuck out of Oklahoma, or at least I was.
Yeah.
You saying you don't absolutely love Oklahoma?
It's fine. It's a fine place to be from, but...
Because normally I ask almost every guest, if I were to move somewhere, why should I move where you're from? But it sounds like there's not a lot of reasons.
I mean, it's cheap.
That's it? That's all you get. It's all Oklahoma's got going for it?
There's good Tex-Mex.
Sure, if you love tornadoes.
If you love tornadoes. I will say, when you get Mexican food or Tex-Mex in Oklahoma, the queso is usually free.
Oh. That's a big plus.
Depending on where you stand with that stuff, that might be reason enough to move.
That's like $2.99 normally.
At least. Unless you put that chorizo in there, and there's like $6.
Jesus. But I will say, I work with a sitar player named Roger Yeager. Who's from Tulsa?
All right, he's from Tulsa.
Oh, interesting.
Friend of the show. Second episode.
Is rad. We played there last year, and I barely recognized it because actually the venue where we got signed by Doghouse was in downtown Tulsa, and I'm like, I shit you not, literal tumbleweeds. Like nothing was happening in downtown Tulsa in the early 2000s, but now it's kind of happening. Like it's a rad place.
I went there a few years ago, and we ate at some cool brewery that was like styled well, and like I was like, okay.
Yeah.
But also, like, Tulsa's a little more hilly. So you said tornadoes. Roger said he's never
really
seen a tornado.
I mean, there's a lot of topography.
Yeah.
Would that be the word?
That's the word. Yeah.
In Oklahoma. There's a lot of flat, but then, then there's, like, a lot of hills and mesas and shit.
Yeah. So did you ever see a tornado there?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, really? Okay. Excuse me. Roger's crazy.
I mean... Again, I'm from the middle of the state, like kind of in between Tulsa and Oklahoma City.
Okay.
And it's more flat, and yeah, I mean, I saw a lot of tornadoes. We would literally just go out on the front porch and watch them. Like that was entertainment.
Bruh.
In the late 1900s.
That is wild.
Yeah. Like, yeah.
I've never seen a tornado with my own eyes. I've seen so many videos because I started watching tornado videos when we moved here.
Yeah.
Because like, you know, within a few months there was like a tornado warning, and I was like, well, I'm gonna die. I never should have moved to Nashville.
I will say I felt like I was desensitized to them. I don't know that I ever saw one touch down. I feel like at least once a year there would be like a tornado season where like literally fucking every day after school I'm watching Fresh Prince or whatever, and like the little tornado warning comes on in the corner of the screen. But I feel like that happened all the time.
Raise your little middle finger.
Well, you can just kind of look outside, like, it looks kind of yellow. I bet there's a tornado. And yeah, sure enough, there usually was. But like, you know, you would maybe see them in the clouds. I can't say I ever stood on my porch and watched a fucking tornado, like, just walk down the street. I don't think I ever saw it touch down, but I was desensitized until I moved here. And they seem more intense here than what I remember growing up.
Mm.
I don't know.
Or just when you're a kid, you're not scared of anything, so...
Maybe so, yeah.
You know? I did a lot dumber, dangerous things when I was young.
Totally.
That I would never even consider now.
Right.
You know? But no, I do want to see a tornado. that's high on my list.
I hear they're remaking Twister.
Really?
Yeah. I don't know why.
It was like an okay movie.
I liked it.
I liked it.
And the soundtrack was bitching.
Yeah, but it wasn't like an instant classic or anything that we need to remake. It was a tornado movie. Like, with, was it Meg Ryan? No.
The other one.
Helen Hunt.
Helen Hunt. Yeah, Helen Hunt.
Was it Bill Paxton?
The other one.
Bill Paxton and Philip Seymour Hoffman.
Oh, sequel.
Oh, shit.
Did they, like... Because at the end of the movie, they figured out how tornadoes work, so we can get early warnings. What are they going to figure out now?
I mean, a lot of the cast is no longer with us, so...
Yeah, when did that come out? 99 or something?
At least.
That's an old movie.
Maybe, because that would be the 25-year anniversary. Wow. Mm. Well, there's that.
Yeah. Makes you feel real young.
Yeah. But, okay, so...
Yeah.
So,
I think we're at Mission Sound.
So we basically did all the rhythm section at Mission Sound. Then we moved to Headgear Studio, which still exists. I looked this up the other day. It was next door to a kickboxing gym. So we had to record when they weren't having kickboxing classes. Cause there was like a lot of like spitting and yelling and that kind of shit.
Yeah.
So,
this studio is underneath a frat. So I really fucking get that.
That's what that is.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
That's why it looks murdery.
Just a tad.
So, like, this is like where the hazing happened.
Maybe those spirits are still here, but I think it's all upstairs.
Okay.
Yeah.
That kind of freaks me out. I would rather it just be fucking haunted.
Yeah.
And have a bunch of college kids around.
Yeah. I feel like worse stuff has probably happened here than if it was just fucking haunted.
Yeah.
But yeah, so we went to this little studio for all the overdubs and the vocals. And then, like, we were sleeping on Tim O'Hare's floor. He was gracious enough to move to across the hall to his girlfriend's apartment and just let us stay in his place.
That's dope.
And he would cook for us every night. It was a great experience. Had a wonderful time making that record. 6 weeks later, we get back in the van. We're like, yes! Like, not only do we have a record deal, like, we just, like, made a record in a real studio, most of it to tape. Like, it was insane. And then we drove back to Oklahoma, and we went to our $75 a month garage apartment. I shit you not. Not $75 each. $75 total.
In 2000, or was this?
2002.
2002?
We drove to New York right after 9/11 to make this record.
Oh my gosh.
It was a fucking trip. And so, yeah, it was early 2002 when we got back home and we were sitting on this record. By that time, like, some people had come by the studio, some managers and some label people and some suits that, you know, we weren't really paying attention. We were just kids, like, fucking making a record. It was awesome. But apparently, like, there was kind of a buzz about it, and so Doghouse wanted to sit on the record until we could kind of see what was what. Like, are we going to upstream this? Is, you know, what's going to happen with this? So we sat at home from February to October playing, you know, just doing what we usually do.
Oh my gosh.
We would go and play bars on the weekend, you know, sometimes down in Dallas, sometimes in Lubbock, sometimes up in Pittsburgh, Kansas, just random fucking places, you know, just in hopes to get $100 to pay for the gas and just get to play our music, maybe sell some CDs from Kinko's. And we did that, and we slept in that shitty garage apartment with bunk beds because it was just one bedroom for the better part of that year. And then finally Doghouse put the record out in 2002, and then we actually got to tour, and that's when everything just kind of felt like it snowballed. For a minute there, we felt like everything was stalled. We're like, what the fuck are we doing? But that summer, we did get to fly to, like, New York and L.A. occasionally and, like, get courted by major labels, which was kind of fun because in 2002, yeah, major labels were still spending a lot of money and, you know, giving bands cash and taking them to strip clubs and shit. So that was kind of fun. But, like, I feel like we got...
You came out right at the cusp.
I feel like we got the last hurrah, like, before everything turned into 360 deals and all that shit.
They were like, maybe if we spend more money on them, it'll work.
It still, in the end of the day, wasn't a lot of money, but it was a major label. It still afforded us to get the single remixed by CLA and make make a video and, you know, do the thing.
And which was Swing Swing?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
And so that was mixed by CLA?
The radio version. The radio, and I imagine it's the video version. The record was mixed by Tim.
Interesting.
But the radio version was mixed by CLA. And then I think we recorded that in December. I mean, now that I say it, like, a lot happened in that year. Even though we sat on our ass in Oklahoma playing bars for 8 months or whatever, like, by December, we were on a major label making a video. So, you know, the way that time goes, like, feels for me now, that sounds very fast. But at the time when you're 19 and 20, like...
Right, when you're just barely able to survive.
Yeah.
And you just went and did this awesome thing, and I just kind of sit there for a year.
Yeah, it was a lot of Hot Pockets.
Yeah.
That's
rough. Top ramen for days.
Yeah, totally.
Was there, like, a period in the interim where, like, you tell your friends, like, we're going to New York, we'll make this record, and you go do it, and then, like... You come back and they're like,
I appreciate your Chris D'Elia voice.
Yeah.
Fuck you. And you come back and they're all like, well, Hotshot, what'd you do out there in New York City?
Well, I mean, yeah, kind of. We lived in a small town, maybe 30,000 people. And, you know,
it's real small.
Yeah. Wow. So, you know, Tyson, like I said, was finishing high school when we got a record deal. And so, like, he was kind of like, the kid with the record deal in high school, like,
dang.
And people knew about it and shit. And then I was teaching guitar lessons at the time. I'd already dropped out of college at this point. But I told my job, I was like, I'm going to make a record. I fucking quit. No more of this teaching shit.
Fuck you.
You're cool. Fuck you. And then we came back and I was like, I mean, what, like, do I need to, like, teach again? Do I need to fucking, I don't know, like work?
Get a job.
Yeah, get a real job.
Hey, man, let's let bygones be bygones.
Yeah. But no, I mean, our rent was fucking $75. Yeah.
Like, right, you could panhandle for that.
Yeah. We made rent in, you know, from selling CDs at our bar shows. It was fine. But yeah, it did feel weird. Like, it was a little, not defeating. It was just weird. It was just like, I don't know if you guys have experienced this, but like, if you're gone and touring for a long time and everything is just revolves around the thing that you're doing out there, and then you come home and you have like responsibilities and
like do the dishes,
real life. It's just like, okay, yesterday everything was different. What the fuck is this? It kind of felt like that. Like, we just drove our fucking van home and it was like,
Shitty van, same garbage apartment. You're like, nothing different.
Yep. I said garage apartment. I didn't say garbage apartment.
Sure. I was reorganizing that
for you. I mean, 601, it's the same shit. But yeah, then after that, yeah, everything just kind of, everything did happen overnight eventually.
Yeah.
Overnight eventually.
That's funny. TM.
Fuck. You got it. Dang it.
Yeah. Well, let's take a quick break. And while we do, we're going to play the dulcet tones of Swing, 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 Swing from My Heart, them All American Rejects.
I actually don't have to pee yet. So.
The song that started it all.
All right.
It's a really long intro, like he said. Okay. We're going to fucking be here for a minute. Oh, we should radio this. Oh, I had the volume down. Oh, that is glorious.
So we're really just going to sit here and listen.
We are.
Oh, shit. Wow. Maybe I should be. The CLA version was also cut in half, the intro. Yeah.
The sun is gone, the nights are long, and I
So that was Swing Swing by the All American Rejects. Check them out, kids.
and we're back.
So, okay, so interesting. You said there's no.
Oh, my bad. It continued playing.
Time of Your Life is the next song after you?
Interesting.
Oh.
All right, I'll take it.
Okay, so maybe we should move past that record, but I did want to ask.
What's up?
So it's interesting. You were actually kind of producing your band before you guys got signed and went to a studio, it sounds like.
Yeah, I mean, not to take anything away from what Tim O'Hare did, because like he produced that record. He got us to New York, he found the studio, he worked a Neve console and a tape machine, like way above my pay grade even now. So he mixed the whole record. He did a great job. But our intention was just to go and kind of re-record the demos that we had, which that's essentially what we did. I think there were probably some things, that we just weren't aware of yet. Like I know Tyson played a lot with backing vocals more in the studio, doubling lead vocals in the choruses, shit like that that I didn't really know about yet.
Sure.
But it just as far as the arrangements and the instrumentation and the parts, like, we were just going to re-record them in a nice space.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm curious, like, so since you were actually somewhat production-minded before you went into that experience, were you paying attention to, like, what Tim did? Were you, like, trying to learn, or were you more thinking about being a band guy at that point? Like, did you walk away learning anything from that experience?
Yes and no. I've been fortunate to have worked with a lot of awesome producers and engineers as an artist. So mm-hmm. It does kind of, I feel like I really wish I would have paid more attention. I did pick up a lot from working with Tim, from working with Eric Valentine or Greg Wells, like amazing record makers. But I think I wish I would have paid more attention to the details. I think I learned more from their process than I actually did from the technical side of things.
Sure.
Because I was kind of, I kind of had to be band guy, music guy.
Right.
And kind of coming off that first record that Tyson and I did myself, like we kind of went into future records with kind of the same mindset, kind of trying to drive the ship and make sure all the parts were working together and all the, the voicings and all that stuff was working.
Something I thought was interesting re-listening to that now.
Mm-hmm.
Going back to your old record, you probably do this too. You go back to old records that you just had experienced as a fan, and now you hear them through a production mindset, and you hear them a completely different way.
Uh-huh. Dude, on the way here, I turned on whatever channel XM, Sirius XM my car was on, uh-huh. and it was fucking Real Big Fish, She's Got a Girlfriend Now, which was my paper route tape. by that, I mean it was the tape that I listened to in my Walkman when I rode my bike and delivered papers in 10th grade.
Amongst all the tornadoes.
Yes. Yeah. Well, the tornadoes.
Did a tornado ever, like, suck you up, take you to a different house, and you're like, thank you?
Well, actually, I did have the largest paper route in my hometown. Not the most papers, but the most, like, actual land to cover. So the tornadoes did come in handy. But Real Big Fish, it does not sound good. Like, those drums are compressed to shit. And I know that was kind of the style with that type of music at the time. But I appreciate it for what it was, and I was super nostalgic about it.
Yeah.
I would not want to try to analyze that with like an engineer or production mindset now, because I wouldn't enjoy it in the same way.
There's a lot of rock music that like it sounds so good, loud, but if you think about like if you play it lower and think about what it is, you're like, this is a bad mix.
Yeah.
Like Song 2 by Blur. Just think about the fucking trailer for Starship Troopers and how epic Song 2 is, right?
Yeah.
Now listen to that on studio monitors. It's just like the fuzz guitar is just the only thing that you hear.
You don't know if it's a guitar or a bass, and you're like, did the bass just stop playing stuff? And like, the bass is just doing a riff now. It's like the song What's the Story, Morning Glory by Oasis.
Yeah. Mm.
Even at a low volume, it's the loudest fucking song I've ever heard, and it's awesome, but I don't know why. Do they just put reverb on the fucking mix bus? I don't know, but it sounds like an empty fucking arena, and I love it.
I was talking to my mastering engineer about that record. Shout out Dan Shike. And dude, I felt like listening into my car. I went and bought the CD when I was like in Denver a few years ago.
Okay.
And was like, because I had an older car, and I was like, I'm gonna listen to this on CD. You know,
oh, full
on 16-bit
44.1. Like music was supposed to be heard.
Well, it's better than Spotify.
That is true.
True. Bit rate.
But just the concept of. You had to quantify that with, I have an older car. Because it has a CD player?
Dude, I have a 2019 Honda, and there's no fucking CD player.
Like, sad.
I've got this fucking visor full of CDs that I can't even use.
You got the big book under the seat.
Yeah, exactly.
Carrying this for 40 years. What do you mean?
I just hope nobody breaks into my car and steals all my CDs.
Right, now they know.
Yeah.
So... I was listening to that record, and my car had a good sound system, and I was like, this is so aggressively bright. It's painful.
But Oasis? Then,
yeah.
Uh-huh. Oh.
What's the story, Morning Glory? Just the album as a, you know.
Yeah,
anyway,
I love that record.
I was like, man, Jesus Christ. And maybe it was just my car. Maybe it was just the CD, because I will be true. Like, true? I will be true.
I will be true.
I will be true. Like, when I listen to that on Spotify now as like a mix reference, I don't think it's too bright, but... At least the CD version, as listened to.
It's all that top end that got cut off when they were compressing it. For
it was just aggressively bright. And then I realized when you hear that album in a bar, like when you're drinking, like your ears like have like a little bit of a roll off. You kind of roll off a little high
if
you drink enough. And I was like, man, if the record's really aggressively bright, sounds a little better in a bar when you're drinking.
If you drink enough, you roll all the sound off.
Oh, that's interesting.
So anyway, that's my little conspiracy theory about What's the Story, Morning Glory. But
that's fucking interesting.
Yeah. Great record.
And I also love that record the older I get, and I've surely lost some top end in my hearing at this point. So
yeah, now it's awesome to us. Yeah. Like, what it's meant to be.
But no, I know what you mean. Like it's I imagine it's like this with any industry, but yeah, I if it's something that I'm super nostalgic about, I try not to be analytical, I guess.
Mm-hmm. You don't want to ruin it.
Yeah. And so, I feel like I'm okay at that. Like there's some stuff, maybe there's some stuff that I just remember from back then that maybe I wasn't the biggest fan of.
I feel like movies are tough with that. Like if you go watch an older movie, like if you're like I grew up watching The Neverending Story.
Love it.
Go back and watch that shit now. You're gonna be like, what the fuck is this? This is some wild dude. Kids watch this?
Have you noticed how fucking long 80s movies are?
Oh my God. Every movie's an epic.
Like, I have a TV in the studio that I meant to be an external display, but it really just plays AMC all day. 80s movies take up like 4 hours on cable. It's
commercial
insane.
Breaks every 15 minutes.
I'm talking comedies. Like, they're so long. Oh my God, what was it? Baby Boom was on the other day.
Baby? I don't even know if I know that.
It's like a 3 hour long comedy.
Was it funny for all 3 hours?
Yeah.
You're like, if you cut an extra hour out of this, it would have been a funnier movie.
Big has been on a lot lately.
Oh,
also,
I love Big.
Great, but so long.
Is it? I don't even remember that. That's.
But yeah, I'm probably more, yeah, like you said, I'm probably more analytical about that shit than I am.
It's interesting music. The way we've, like, accustomed to quick edits that tell the story, and we've accepted the medium. I was watching, I have like a 64 Thunderbird, and I'm trying to learn how the fuck carburetors work. And so I watched this video that was made in the 50s, and I forget what step of the process they were on, but they were doing a basic human thing everyone knows how to do. They were showing it as an example. And instead of editing, like, we did this, we did that, we did that.
Uh-huh.
They just showed the whole process. It was like a...
Kind of like you just played that whole song a second ago.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, TikTok, we should have done 20 seconds. I mean, we would get more listeners if we did 5 seconds.
Right.
Let's be real.
Well, it's funny you say that because I feel like even with you know, obviously with music, our attention span has gotten much shorter. But, you know, like I was even saying with Swing Swing, I don't know if you can find the CLA mix / edit out there, but... If you compare them, like, they cut everything in half. Like, organ intro in half, guitar intro in half, last chorus, just fucking cut it. We don't need that fade out. And I listen back to some of those songs, and I'm like, man, if we did this today, like, all this shit would be cut in half. Like, the re-intro is fucking 8 bars. No, make that 4, man. 2.
You're
make
like, they
two.
Were right along?
Yeah. It's like watching a fucking 80s movie. It's crazy.
Even now, I feel like... Even modern movies, I'm really I'm very critical of movies. I don't like to watch movies that suck.
I mean, I subscribe to that.
Yeah. And so I'm very critical. It drives my wife crazy because she'll be like, let's watch this movie. And I'll be like, let me Google it real quick. Let's see what the world thinks.
IMDb reviews.
IMDb's
not really bad. iTunes reviews. I don't really care about that.
I use Rotten Tomatoes.
I do Rotten Tomatoes and IMDb.
But you got to look at the audience score in Rotten Tomatoes. Yes. That's the key. Don't look at the critic score. That's bullshit. It's nonsense.
Yep.
It literally means nothing. But even now, I'm like, you need to cut things out of most movies. I feel like I'm bored by the end.
Yeah, and that's why I've never seen, since the original Iron Man is the last superhero movie I saw.
That's the best one, so you're good.
Okay, because they're all fucking 3 hours long. Like, we've been sitting here 30 minutes. I've already peed twice since I got here. Like,
movie takes you 3 days.
I'm not going to. Dude, it took me 2 nights to watch Elvis.
Oh, and that's a pretty decent movie.
Pretty decent movie. But
I thought the beginning kind of dragged a bit, I felt like.
I don't even remember it. But all I know is that I had to stop in the middle. I was like, well, I guess I'm finishing this tomorrow.
Oh, man. Yeah, I can't. Like, can't do it.
So, a comedy, 90 minutes is my cutoff.
100%. If it goes longer than that, it better be the funniest movie I've ever seen in my life.
If it goes longer than that, it better be the fucking director's cut. Yeah. 2 hours, I can give you around 2 hours. If it's like a fucking good like Denzel action movie, fuck yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah, that's where I draw the line. I will not go to the theater and watch a movie longer than 2 hours. Hell no.
Did you watch The Irishman when that came out? And that was a big thing like a couple years ago. It was like 4 hours long.
Fuck no. Show me the Cliff's Notes. Is there like a? There should be like a Netflix Cliff's Notes.
Hey, I bet you someone's edited it down to regular movie length. Like, here's what you actually need
That'd
to see.
That'd be nice. Yeah. Just like they do with podcasts. Like, I'm sure you're going to go and like cut out all like the awkward pauses.
No, we are not.
You're not? Okay.
No, there's going to be
We go
there.
Up just like it is live.
Sick. Okay. Well, to be fair, there hasn't been an awkward pause yet. But you know what I mean? Like, they should actually go through the movie and just chop out all that fucking dead air. Mm-hmm. I don't need that.
But the thing is, to tell a really good story, sometimes you need the extra time.
Nah, fuck that.
But that's what TV's for. give it to me an episode.
Dude, I was watching Columbo this weekend.
Columbo?
Episode of Columbo was 2 fucking hours, but that?
What?
That I'm here for. That was great. That was great fucking TV.
Columbo?
Yeah! Dude, he didn't even make an appearance in the first hour. There was like backstory of like the murderer, like, and then like I'm like, man, like it's been almost an hour. Like, he better get in here and fucking wrap this up. Oh yeah, one more thing. But no, I'm like, oh, there's another hour. That's when Peter Falk comes in, is the back half.
I think I've seen maybe like an episode of Columbo.
Oh, it holds up. It's great.
It does it.
Oh yeah,
it's like one of the original like cop shows, kind of.
Yeah, I mean, you know, he's bumbling, and he's fucking, like, has no social skills whatsoever, but he's a fucking genius, and he always gets his man.
What's crazy is, like, all those guys, Sherlock Holmes included.
Sure.
Like, a lot of these characters are probably just on the spectrum, and we didn't have those words.
Yeah.
Well, in Sherlock, I don't know if you watched Sherlock, or watched Sherlock when it was on, the BBC one with Benedict Cumberbatch.
I saw the Robert Downey Jr. one.
Oh. Those are okay.
Oh, I don't remember.
They're okay. But the show, if you've never seen the show, it's phenomenal. If you're into that kind of thing. Oh my God, yeah. Okay. Each episode is an hour and a half, though. But there's only 3 episodes a season. And there's only 4 or 5 seasons.
What kind of format is that?
It's English, you know. Who knows what they're doing? It's from BBC makes it.
I will say, they don't, like, just, what's the word? They don't ruin shows by just letting them stay on too long. Showtime show ever. The worst. I can already tell season 2 of Yellow Jackets. I'm like, this is, they've already ruined it.
No. Yeah. Season 2 is so good.
Really?
I just watched both seasons like a week ago.
I feel like I'm already at like Dexter season 7 at this point watching that show.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, no, I can't wait for season 3.
Oh, no, I definitely did. And I definitely rewatched it before they did the latest season, which I did like.
Yeah.
I will say binging Dexter, not doing it week to week. That was brutal, because I was like, literally nothing happened today. This fucking episode was stupid. Like, I can't wait a week for more garbage. But when you binge it, like, it's like, okay, this is fine.
Right, get to the story.
Yeah, and I did like the new season, but I digress.
Did you want him? Oh, I shouldn't. Never mind. Sorry.
It's been long enough. Spoilers are fine at this point.
I thought it ended perfectly. I think it needed to happen. I do think it's bullshit how even when like limited series come out now, they're like, we might want to do another season or a movie, so let's kind of leave it open at the end.
No,
like,
just end it. End your story.
You know the kid got his girlfriend pregnant, and you know there's going to be a little Dexter fucking next season or whatever.
Like, a little Dexter.
I didn't.
That's a good name. TM.
idea.
I didn't want it to end how it ended. I see how it needed to.
You wanted him to kill his son, didn't you?
you heartless son of a bitch.
I just always supported Dexter no matter what. I just wanted him to go on.
Me too.
You got to pull that down a little bit. You're on top of the clock. Oh, that's why Schitt's Creek is so good? But Schitt's Creek is long, right?
They got canceled and then even restarted on fucking like some like, I don't know, like you can only watch it at a gas pump station. Like, what was that called?
What? You mean like when you go to the gas station with little TVs? Yeah.
What is that on Modern Family?
They're
like,
how many times I've been a little bit scared by Welcome to Shell.
Yeah. Jesus Christ. It's like 1 a.m.
One of my favorite Modern Family quotes is they ask Haley, the oldest daughter, like, don't you watch the news? And she's like, yeah, at the gas station.
Oh, man. No.
Music. I told you I'd drag you off. Yes.
I told you I would.
Yeah.
There was best at.
It was a tangent followed by an awkward pause, so we're doing good. Yeah.
So, I mean, I'm curious because I think it's really cool. So, you're a producer, an engineer, and, like, that's, I mean, I'm sure when you're 19, that's not what you're doing, but, like, that's something that you're doing now. But being in, like, a band that got to work with some of these, you listed Eric Valentine and Greg Wells, like, these are some of the top guys in the game. That's really incredible that you got to kind of experience from the other side some of the greats, like, of the current recording industry.
Yeah, so, super, super lucky. And just, you know, getting to watch, not watching a great producer make a record solely on Pro Tools. You know what I mean? Like, actually getting to immerse myself in, like, you know, we made our record with Eric Valentine, we made solely to tape. That entire record is tape.
Wow. And which record was that?
That was our third record, When the World Comes Down. The Gives You Hell one. Nobody bought that record, but that's the song.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Everyone knows that song. And to be fair to you, no one was buying records anymore when that happened.
I tell you what, it's funny. I got a couple plaques, and I'm not the guy that like hangs them up in my house. That's weird. But I built a studio, and so I'm like, you know what? This is a separate space from my home. Like, I need to flex a little bit. I'll hang up a couple plaques.
Yeah.
So I got a plaque for the first record, the second record, but the plaque for the third record was not just for record sales, because like you said, nobody was buying records. It lists ringtones.
Oh no!
It lists digital downloads.
Historic document. That is a historic document.
Yep. So I have a ringtones plaque for that record.
That's amazing.
Wow. Yeah.
I hadn't even thought about the idea of purchasing a ringtone.
When was the last time your phone rang?
I haven't heard my phone in years.
It's obscene.
Yeah. If somebody's phone rings in public, you're like mad at that person. Yeah. You're just like, the fuck do you think you are? Turn that shit off.
Or on a plane? Ugh. Disgusting.
Dude, I almost wanted to find it, but the worst one is the one that's kind of based off the baseball game that's like, boom, 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 boom. And it's got the whistles in
the
background.
One more time.
You know what I'm talking about? And in the background, it's got like a woot, woot, woot.
I have no idea what you're talking about.
We'll show you and you'll be like, I hate that.
All right, we need to clip that and layer those two sounds.
Guys, you will know this sound when I.
How are you gonna find that? How are you gonna? What are you gonna Google?
Trust me, it's on your
ChatGPT.
Hey Siri.
It's probably in the classic section.
Oh, you think you have it like on the phone? Now we're just gonna listen to ringtones for the next 2 minutes while he figures it out.
Yeah, we might be. It might be. It's in here.
Oh my god!
All right, we're not gonna find it. The point is.
No, keep going.
It's
please.
One. That
high quality content. That.
When I play it, you'll know it from your nightmares.
Okay,
you're gonna get a text at like 3 a.m. Like, this I found it.
Oh no, you won't. You'll get the sound. I will find a way to make that alert happen.
That better happen.
So anyway, so that was your Eric Valentine record,
right? And yes, I guess kind of what I was saying earlier. Like I got to make these records with these amazing engineers and producers. But I also kind of had to be like musical director guy too. So I didn't get to absorb all that I wish I had, but I definitely learned from the experiences and from their process and from the way that they deal with artists. Because I feel like there's a lot of psychology that goes into making records too. And every band is the same. Every band has four or five people, and there's four or five personality types, and everybody in every band inhabits one of those. And so, like,
except for during the ska period, another band had 17 people in it.
Right. Right. Yeah, I wonder if there were more personalities back. I wonder if there was like a trombone, like
oh yeah,
he's clearly the trombone player. You know what I mean?
Bro, I had a guy in here the other night.
So I tried to bring us back, but yes, yeah, please, I'm, by all means.
Good luck.
Long story short, he was the trombone player for
Save Ferris.
No.
Dancehall Crashers.
Nope. Johnny Lang.
He's not ska.
No, he's not ska. But he like dropped it on me, and he's this old, old man from Florida. It's a longer, more interesting story. However, fucking Eric Valentine. What did you learn from him? And I'm curious, like, did you ever on their end of the band, because I work some like you were saying psychology. Mm-hmm. I work some psychology on people and kind of
sure.
like But did you ever feel that from a producer? Like, did you ever like, I see your tricks. I see what you're trying to do to me.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm sure. I do know, like, I'm the kind of guy who if the demo's there and I feel solid about it, but then I get to the studio and they're like, an example I'm thinking of was the Greg Wells record we made. There was a song where there was a guitar solo, but the end, it kind of just got repetitive. And he was like, I think it needs to, like, just, I don't know, get a little crazy in the end. And he definitely had something in mind. Mm. And I was like, everybody leave the room. Like, leave me alone for a little bit. So I just, like, took the room for, like, an hour and just fucked around. And I was like, I just can't unhear what's on the demo. Mm. And, yeah. like, he kind of started, like, doing a little thing. I was like, that's it. Okay, I got it. Shut up. And but, like, I feel like he kind of had, like, he had a direction that he wanted me to go. And, like, without literally writing the part and showing me what to do, coached me to come up with something that everybody thought was really fucking cool. I think that's the key. You don't want to, I mean, I've been guilty of writing a part in my head and then somehow getting a drummer or somebody to literally come up with that exact thing I wanted.
Yeah.
Without realizing it. And I thought that was the goal. I think the goal is exactly what Greg did to me. It's not this, but something like this. You know what I mean? Just coaching an artist to actually maybe get out of their comfort zone, maybe do something different than their instincts would initially, you know, guide them to do. But just like, I want something kind of bluesy and crazy at the end. Like, what would you do? That's in that realm. You know what I mean? And I think that's the goal. I think it's to push the artist to come up with their own voice to serve the song and the record and what the producer is getting paid to do. You know what I mean? To make the best, you know, recording and the best representation of that song possible.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Oh, yeah, absolutely, okay. Man. 100%. Do you feel like you end up using some of those lessons, like, as you're producing, do you, like, flashback on, like, oh, shit, this is what Greg was doing, or this is
oh, totally. Yeah. And that's kind of a realization I've come to more recently, and it's, like, experiences like that. Or, like, you know, I in the records that I've made, you know, in my band and as an artist versus the records I'm making as a producer or a writer, I pile it on. It's all about just like every 2 to 4 bars introduce something new. And then when that last chorus hits, everything you've heard is all happening at once.
Yeah.
It's really fun to do. It's really easy to do, but I'm trying to get better at muting stuff. And I do remember like being really excited about a part. And if it was Eric Valentine, spending half a day on one fucking overdub for that second verse or whatever, you know what I mean? And then getting the mix back and being like, I remember him sending a mix. He's like, you don't have any comments about that second verse? And I'm like, no, it sounds fucking great, man. Like, there were probably comments otherwise, but like, he was specifically asking about that part. And I was like, no, it sounds great. He's like, you didn't notice that I muted that thing? And I'm like, oh, fuck. Like, no, like, I don't need that. So like, yeah, like just intentional mutes I'm finding is, and leaving space and like not quadrupling every fucking guitar, even though that's really fun too.
I'm personally a huge fan of empty space in music.
Yeah.
Like, I like there to be less music per music in the music I listen
less
to.
Music per I love that. Say TM really fast.
TM, okay. That's mine. Nobody else gets it. But it was what you just said made me think. I'm a software developer during the day.
Oh,
so
nice.
I write code.
Fuck yeah.
And I read something that some famous coder guy, I mean, fuck, I don't know, some guy said. He said something like, when you write code, like, just because it works doesn't mean that it's done. It's not until you can't remove anything else.
Hmm. Explain that.
So, well, I mean, when it comes to code, like, you can solve a problem any number of ways. Mm-hmm. But how much of that is unnecessary? How much can you do it in an easier way or a simpler way or not go use these complicated libraries and still get the same result in a much more efficient and better way?
Work harder, not smarter.
Yeah. And I'd never really thought that might, like, relate back to music. Mm-hmm. But, like, kind of what you're saying makes sense. Like, if you can remove it and it does that makes it better, then it's not done.
Totally.
You know what I mean?
And I think... yeah, I think it's about keeping people's interest for sure, because like nobody's going to listen to a song longer than like 2.5 minutes these days. I think it's what you do with the space. It's not just like filling it up with just like bombardment with like constant melodies
like wall
and
of
development.
Sound.
Yeah. Which that's fun too, but
right. Yeah, there's definitely a place for that as well. It's less my vibe. But.
I feel like there was something I was gonna. You were talking about the computer coding thing. There was a
software development. Coding, removing stuff. Lots of ways to solve a problem.
Minimalism.
Yeah. What'd you say?
Minimalism.
Minimalism. Yeah.
It's very Rick Rubin.
Oh. But on the other hand, I remember, and I stole this from Eric, something that he said that I just thought was fucking amazing. No, I got this from Frasier.
The same.
That's a great place
almost
to get things from.
Well, it's riffing on the same phrase, but. Anytime we just wanted to keep stacking bullshit on a record, Eric would go, more is more.
Yeah.
From Frasier, what I got is, if less is more, just imagine how much more would be. And I love that one, too.
That's a great line.
Yeah. I can't TM that. That one's already taken. But I do love it, and I do use it often.
I heard Jim Adkins on a podcast talking with somebody, and he said, more is more. He's always subscribed to more is more.
Yeah.
And I was like, thank you, Jim.
Yeah.
Daddy J. I was like, because we went through such a phase of minimalism, mm-hmm. like in art, in music, and everything.
Yeah, I ate that shit up. Yeah. I love that still.
Nom, nom, nom.
I did that on one episode, and now you're going to bring that up every time.
You need like a special graphic for that.
We need a
special button. Yeah.
The delay.
You can edit that out, you know. The delay.
We don't.
We won't.
Okay. All
right. But, God, I don't even remember what we're talking about.
You're talking about Daddy.
Yeah. When he said more is more, I was like, thank you, because I like lots of things on a record. It's really fun.
Yeah.
And, like, everybody's like, no, less is more.
I'm going to go on a limb here and say you might not want to call him Daddy if you ever want to come on the show.
Sure. No, but here's the thing. We can't have Jimmy Eat World on this show. There's one good reason.
Why's that?
The Jimmy Eat World shrine in the front.
Yeah, you have to cover that shit up.
Do you think they would notice?
Probably not. Nobody notices unless I point it out.
Which you always do.
Yeah. I know,
like,
I don't.
I thought you were going to take that record out and I was going to see more Jimmy Eat World records behind it. Like, I was like, what are we, like, shrine? Like, there's like one thing here. Like, I don't. And then I got, you positioned it to show the cigarette machine.
It takes a little effort.
And the trophies.
Right.
So maybe they wouldn't.
So it's like a magic eye. Yeah. I had to stand there for a little bit.
Sorry, if you can go ahead and superimpose a picture of your setup and the record here in the show, that would be great.
I won't remember. If you had come in and I had like an old fucked up go-kart sitting in the front with like leaves underneath it.
Probably wouldn't ring a bell.
Wouldn't ring a bell.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it'd be like, there'd be candles, it'd be all lit. Anyway. Okay, never mind.
Making
Jimmy
the go-kart sexy? Yeah, I wouldn't. Yeah.
They'd never get it. I just wouldn't point out the shrine. I would be like, I'm a normal person.
I'm a normal person.
Yeah. What makes it worse is that's not the only Jimmy Eat World shrine in the studio. There's also one in the bathroom, right?
Really?
Right, don't you have you used to have like the frame picture from when you and I went and you got like the drumstick or whatever.
That's a great question. I don't even know. Yeah, I went to their
Chase This Light album release in LA. Nice. And
whoa, though, what I'm talking about is from the Invented album release.
I went to the Invented album. I've gone to most of their album releases.
Wait, which one was Invented? Was that Coffee and Cigarettes?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. That's good. Yeah.
We drove home. We went and saw that, the release. We went to Tucson and Phoenix for that one.
Oh, shit. You went to the motherland.
We did.
Yeah.
We sure did.
Look at you.
Back in San Diego days, it's like 6 hours.
Oh, okay.
Right. And gotcha. So, from here, that's a much bigger trip.
Yeah.
But we drove home, listened to that album, drinking coffee, smoking cigarettes, and then Coffee and Cigarettes came on. It was like a perfect moment.
So meta. I love
yeah.
it.
Yeah. Yeah. It was a moment in time. But anyway, okay, so... Did you guys record, when you recorded with Valentine, did you go to Barefoot Sound?
Mm-hmm.
Like, I've only seen videos, but, like, it seems like he's a little wizard. Like,
mad scientist.
Yeah, the umbrella.
Drumbrella.
Baffle over the drums.
Yeah.
Like,
which I've seen other places now. I feel like that's his proprietary thing,
100%.
Though. And it was on a motor, so it could, like, raise and lower over
yeah.
the drums.
No one had that. He invented that.
I think he invented it after he did that Queens record. Because he put Dave Grohl in, like, the breezeway between the control room and the lobby. It's like... probably smaller than this room, just to get that super tight, dry drum sound for that record. And then after that, I think he incorporated the drumbrella into the tracking room. So he could just like,
yeah, I love that.
So he could shrink, you know, basically shrink the room, but keep the drums in the same place. He did do the thing though, where he kept all the mic pre's by the drum kit so that the cable length between the microphones and the pre's were as short as possible.
Yep.
So if he needed to tweak a level, he had to send his assistant out there to...
That's a whole next level. I'm not to that level. I'm not to that level of like
having the system.
I gotta have the pre's next to the drums.
Right.
I'm not there.
I was actually just remembering that because I did a drum session yesterday where I do have the new Warm Audio Ampex mod, like their version of the Ampex tape pre's, but it lives in the tracking room by the microphone.
You're on that level.
But it's only because I don't have enough room in my patch bay to like plug it into my racks, so it just lives out there by the drums. But let's go with the cable length.
The cables must be made of solid gold, strung from the tail of a unicorn.
Right, or with a little impedance dial. He did that too.
Wow.
But no, it was an interesting time when we made our record there because he was designing his console, the Undertone like console. And he had all of the pieces of it. It just wasn't assembled. There was no chassis. There was nothing. He had his EQs like just stacked up on milk crates. And he had just this row of faders on milk crates. And there's no aesthetic there whatsoever.
Yeah.
But that's not how he works. He doesn't need it to be like sexy and vibey.
It's got to be good.
He'll just nerd out and spend forever on just the sound. There's no window to the between the control room and the tracking room for sound purposes.
Oh wow.
But he has like little security cameras everywhere so he can like at least have a sight line. But yeah, that was a trip because it looked a lot different after that. Like the videos you probably saw and like the way that it looked when he sold it, like it looked way different when we were there. It was very DIY when we were there.
Interesting.
But it was great. I mean, it doesn't matter. It sounded just as good as it probably sounded when it looked great too. You know what I mean? He just wasn't about all that. But like, I can tell that you guys appreciate aesthetics and I certainly do in my studio as well. Like I want people to feel like, they just like walked in a time warp, like, whoa, we're gonna make a fucking record.
Hey, you wanna walk in and be
70s.
Like, this is so cool.
Yeah, like right? I wanna spend time here. I don't wanna leave.
Right. And you will be spending a lot of time there.
Yeah, exactly.
So you better enjoy it.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yep. That's why I put a bathroom in there. That's why I put a fucking coffee, you know, sick coffee setup in there. Yeah. Nice. That's where we live.
So how long has the studio been open?
I started designing the studio early 2020, and then COVID happened, and the government started working from home, like I was telling you earlier. So permitting was a fucking nightmare. I think we finally broke ground in the fall of 2020, and I started working out of it about a year ago. It was very barefoot, circa 2008, like aesthetically a nightmare, but I'd say after about 6 months ago, it was complete enough to be like, okay, I feel like it's done. You know what I mean? Toilets in. All the aesthetics are done. I'd say it's been complete for about 6 months. Now you say open. I didn't open it as a commercial space.
Sure, I rent
it out for friends because I think it's a great drum room. And live drums are cool again, which is awesome. So I am renting it out to friends, you know, for stuff like that.
Sure.
Like I said, I just like the aesthetics and the vibe of a classic studio. So like, it's like this space too. It's like, I feel like the space at least helped. If it doesn't help the art, it helps the artist be more comfortable to make the art.
Yeah.
I've had so many great experiences in studios that like I want to continue that, and I want to be able to share that, and I want to be able to offer that. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So.
Yeah, I saw the you had a tour. What's the guy's name who does the?
Did you see the Andrew Masters thing?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, so you had like a lot of like kind of reverberant spaces in there, or like. Mm-hmm. Or reflective surfaces.
Diffusive, yeah.
Yeah. Now, so I saw like rock wall looking stuff. Mm-hmm. So, like, what's that? Is that like fake rock panels? Is it rock? Like, what do you do?
It's real stone. It's a facade. Like, it's probably only like, you know, an inch thick or whatever.
But it's real stone.
It is, yeah. So the idea is in the live room, every surface is reflective.
Oh, that's cool.
Around the floor is more absorbent, like where the mic panels and shit are. But like everything from, you know, waist up and even the ceiling is reflective, diffusive, and just to make it sound bigger, because
yeah,
it's in a historic district, so the footprint was limited. Hmm. It's all about making that 15x20 room sound like it's a bigger live room.
Yeah.
But honestly, what I end up doing the most is putting a microphone or two in the lobby where all the tile and drywall is,
yeah.
And that's just that's my room sound.
Yeah. What kind of drum sounds do you like get out of that room? Like, is there maybe there's a variety. Like, I feel like in my room, like what works great in my room, you can fake it being a bigger room or live,
yeah,
or whatever. But like, what works really great in my room is like Fleetwood Mac, 70s, mm-hmm, drier tones. I talked with Joe Costa like years ago, and he was just like, dry, like, if you have it as dry as you can have it, like, the bleed that you're going to have is just going to be a better situation in a small room. And so I went on the drier, tighter side.
Yeah, yeah.
And then, so I've taken this, like, trip down the 70s.
Oh, yeah.
Because that's an easier drum tone for me to get in here. But what do you get in the room with, like, because I'm tempted to put rock, like, a rock facade in. Like, I feel like that could be a cool new adventure.
East Iris here in town has an amazing stone drum room.
Yep.
And actually, we can play one of the songs that I tracked there.
You used to work there?
Yeah.
What did you do there? And when were you there?
Oh, 2012, when I first moved here.
Oh, shit. Okay, yeah, that was before I got here. But. Yeah.
I answered the phone and bought Don Henley soup. And
what kind of soup does he eat?
Oh, bro. <don't> Dog, this is... I don't call people dog, but I have to in context of the story. Don Henley will never listen to this podcast.
He listens to every episode.
That's true.
He's kind of your biggest fan.
Yeah. If somebody's listening to this that thinks that I'm wrong about this, I'm sorry.
Fight me, bro.
Feel free.
Yeah.
No, feel free. But Don Henley seemed like a gruff old man to me, and he wasn't nice.
Okay.
My first day working at East Iris, at the time called House of Blues,
yeah,
he calls up the front desk that I'm at. I've been there for 5 minutes. He goes, "This is Don Henley. He's mad in the tape room." And I'm like, "Fuck." Bro, I don't know if we have a tape room. I've never heard of Matt. And Jesus Christ.
He wants you to calibrate the tape machine.
Yeah, Don Henley knows who he is and wants the front desk guy to know it too. And anyway, that was a sign of everything to come. He's just a very, like, when he walks in, he, like, just walks in, like, with a scowl. He just is a scowler.
Maybe he's just having a bad day.
Maybe it was a bad supplement.
Maybe he got the wrong soup. What kind of fucking
soup
is he
eating?
So We had the, and this dovetails into to you actually. I watched your little studio tour video. Not on purpose at all. I watched your studio tour video, and I saw you had a menu book.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Again,
such a good touch.
Working in commercial studios, there's always a menu book. Like, and there's a sign out front you can put the artist's name on so they know they're in the right spot. They know they know where to park. Mm. Because I remember getting to work at the Village. Actually, we got to work in the room that Fleetwood Mac built for Tusk to get those drum sounds. That was fucking epic. But I remember pulling up, and we didn't have our name in the parking lot, but T-Bone Burnett did. And I was like, that's a fucking baller move.
Fucking, okay, first day at House of Blues, Studio A, Don Henley with Stan Lynch, drummer Tom Petty. Producing.
Yeah, oh, fuck, man.
Studio D, T-Bone Burnett.
Yep.
Those were the people around, I was working. Yeah, he's a fucking, what a slut.
He's
anyway,
the man.
for those who are curious, T-Bone Burnett uses... Maple Sunrise cereal from Whole Foods because it's gluten free.
That was my next question.
Yeah, I knew it.
Yeah. But I don't think we've heard what kind of soup.
I'm still waiting on the fucking soup. You know what? Don Henley probably is too, and that's why he's so fucking pissed.
Yeah. Okay, so they had a menu book, and I was the arbiter of the menu book.
Okay,
as
sure.
you have yep. in your studio. That was what I was
that's
saying.
Where we were. Okay,
thank you. So one day, Don Henley says to me,
One day,
like
Don Henley
a
says
joke.
To me,
"Yeah,
I walked into a bar with Don Henley, and
he goes, have you ever eaten at this place before?
What place was it?
Guess it was Panera.
I was going to think about Barry Hill and be like, okay, who serves soup around there? I probably would have gotten it like by the second try.
It was just...
That's amazing.
Have you ever had this place before? And I was like, Panera? Yeah, I guess. Like, it's just all... He's all, what's good there? What which soup is better? And I was like, I haven't had that
I haven't
soup.
Sampled their whole damn menu. Yeah. I don't...
And so he goes...
I don't work at Panera.
So from what I remember, Panera had two soups... And he just said, well, get me both and I'll just see. You know, just get both.
Dude, man, to have that kind of fuck you money to just order both the soup.
Two soups here, motherfucker.
Put them both in a bread bowl. Fucked.
So.
Was it
I bring done-
tomato and chowder? Was that what it was?
I feel like it was a white one that could be the chowder.
Okay.
I don't remember the other. I brought them both back. In the end, you know which one he ate? Fucking neither of them.
I was going to say neither. That's amazing.
Don Henley hates Panera. I just
The worst thing that happened with me and Don Henley is that
he didn't eat your soup.
He came in. The soup was kind of a low blow, but he came in one day. Do you know who Richie Furay is? You know Buffalo Springfield. Mm-hmm. He was in that band.
Okay.
And he was also in a band called Poco. You had to calm down.
Okay. The soup got you all riled up.
It did. So Richie Furay, other, you know, not as famous as Don Henley, but also super successful guy from the 70s, also recording there at the same time.
Okay.
So one day... Don comes up to me in the front desk and he says, if Richie Furay and his people come up here, don't let them in. And by the way, if you're catching a connection with my voicing of Don Henley and Donald Trump, they are similar types of, it's a similar
cadence.
Energy. It's just so everyone knows.
Interesting. Well, you know him better than any of us. Would he appreciate that comparison?
It's hard to say.
I don't know which way he swings.
I don't think so.
Okay.
No, I think Don Henley is like, is very liberal.
Okay.
But he has Donald Trump's level of fuck you. You know?
Okay.
Everyone can say fuck you at the end of the day.
sure.
But I just, yeah.
I don't get the reference. Continue.
I don't know.
So anyway, the point is that he comes in and says, do not let Richie Furay and his people in here, because he was recording in Studio A.
Okay.
But the thing is that they had a session booked. And so when they came in for their session, I, as a 25-year-old guy working a front desk at a recording studio
like,
in a new town.
Who's Richie Pure?
I didn't feel comfortable telling his entourage of 10 people, don't go back there. And they just walked straight on in.
Don Henley wants to fight you. Don't go back there.
15 minutes later, they come out, walk, huffing and puffing out, and his manager was Joe Walsh's manager.
Okay.
And he comes out, and he comes to me at the front desk. Nice guy, nice old hippie. And he's just like, I hate Don Henley. He says, I don't hate anyone. I love the whole world. Long-haired, fucking old hippie.
Yeah.
I love everyone in the whole world. I fucking hate Don Henley.
Jesus.
That's some dirty laundry right there.
Oh, snap.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Full circle. So, tell me more about being a producer and shit.
And shit.
Yeah. Have you worked with anybody like anybody who you're like super into? Anyone you think is super cool that you've been that you've worked
yeah,
with?
Yeah, I mean, I get to just kind of work on stuff that I like and that I'm excited about. You know, when I moved to Nashville in 2015, and I wrote and worked with anybody just to get the experience because I'd only worked one way my entire life. I'd written with one person for 15 years at that point. So I learned quickly what I liked to do, what I hated doing, and just kind of navigating what kind of artists were here because I'd come from L.A. I grew up in Oklahoma, but I lived in L.A. before this. It's a totally different scene than what I was used to. You know, I didn't have to sit in traffic here, which was fucking glorious. And, you know, now...
is ending that era.
Yeah, that's...
I know. Well, I don't know. They come to me now.
Yeah, fair enough.
But, like, yeah, even when I was a kid, like, I was the guy that had the recording stuff. So, like, I like that setup where, like, I've got my space. I know how to be creative, and I have, a good workflow here. Come here, and we'll work together. But, yeah, it's... I'm also at a point in my life where I'm like, I don't need to like hustle and like everything is not an opportunity anymore. Like,
you just do what you like to do.
Yeah. And like coming up in this industry, especially on the artist side, like having like, you know, whatever manager at the time, whatever label at the time, like be like, hey, this thing came up. Do you want to do it? And we're like, I mean, no, not really. Like, well, it'd be good if you did. Mm-hmm. Like everything being an opportunity, like that's kind of programmed in me, so unlearning that has been tricky, but you know, I think I've really found the kind of projects and the kind of artists that I like working with, and honestly, like, I like working on stuff that I would listen to, and I like working with people that are fun to work with. I think there was a mentality in making records, and we experienced it a little bit on the way out. The whole like misery creates good art kind of thing.
Yeah.
And maybe when it comes to like writing music, certain artists do need to be fucking miserable. Like, I get it. Everybody has their process. But when you come into the studio to, even if you're just laying it down and recreating a demo, or if you're kind of building something from the ground up, like that should be a fun collaborative process. And I don't think you need to have a miserable time to get something, to get a good result.
Yeah.
So that being said, I just like working with people that I enjoy hanging out with. I enjoy collaborating with. I enjoy, you know, finding people who not only can like finish each other's sentences, but like kind of elaborate on each other's ideas, I guess. And that tends to be, you know, a lot more rock stuff, a lot more kind of alternative stuff. And, you know, I also like working with solo artists where I get to kind of play everything. Like, that's always fun, too.
Yeah.
But, yeah, I mean, it's also, like, the way people make music nowadays, they don't camp out in the studio for whether it's 6 weeks at Tim O'Hare's apartment or 9 months at Barefoot with Eric Valentine. The budget and the time isn't there anymore. Artists have to block out content days now, which I guess is a thing.
Wild.
So
content day.
Yeah. So the schedule is different. But I also feel like I remember hearing stories. Eric would tell stories about some artists that he worked with that were very hands-off compared to the way we were used to making records. And, like, they would rarely be at the studio. And I'm like, how does the record get made? But it's all the editing and all the post-production and all that bullshit. It's like when you're just on the producer side, you're like, oh, my God, I didn't realize making a record was 75% fucking vocal editing. You know what I mean? So, yeah, sometimes I'm like, yeah, you know what? Honestly, don't show up for 3 days. I got shit to do.
Wow.
Yeah. But I don't even know where I was going with that. I forgot what the
That's
question was. But
it doesn't matter.
This is making records in 2023, man.
So we were talking about
the question was there anybody awesome
who you worked with? Oh, yeah, tons.
Yeah, who like we should keep an eye out for.
Yeah.
This stuff's coming out that we should, you know.
Yeah, I just did a bunch of songs with this local artist, Manny Blue. He was a solo kind of country rock thing, but he just decided to ditch the country and make a rock record, which I was like, fuck yeah,
hell
let's
yeah.
do that. And he's got a new band coming out called Her Leather Jacket. They I think the first single that we did comes out next week, actually, on, I don't know when this comes out, but
that's a cool band name.
Yeah, right?
That
yeah.
that feels like when I was younger.
Yeah, and they got a sick logo too. It's great. But I think the first single comes out June 30th, called One of Everything. And that was a lot of fun because, like I said, the project did start kind of, you know, trying to appease both rock fans and country fans.
Mm-hmm.
But then...
And you realize they hate each other?
Well, it's one of those things that's like, what kind of music do you listen to? Everything. Well, no. Where I grew up, it was you either like country or you didn't.
Oh, yeah. The number one thing I heard growing up, you ask people what music they're into, they go, I'll listen to anything but country.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. And that's kind of where I grew up. It was either like country or anything but.
Yeah.
So like they rarely cross paths, but you know, a lot of people have had success doing that. And it is interesting what some artists are pulling off. But I think deep down what he decided, and you know, fortunately for me, that's what I love working on is fucking rock music. So let fucking mute the acoustics, fucking crank the guitars and put some fucking loud drums in there. It's a lot of fun. So that's coming out. We did four songs together. I mean, we did a lot, but I think four songs are going to be released this year. You know, I think a big project that I got to work on was at East Iris. I did the Cassidy Pope record Thrive. It was her last LP. That was a lot of fun. That was also in Nashville. I mean, she's not a Nashville artist. She's a pop punk kid who moved to Nashville and had a lot of success in the country area, but I got to do the record where she was kind of pushing the boundaries of that and kind of wanting to do more, you know, pop punk and rock stuff. So that was a lot of fun. Worked with this band from Joplin, Missouri called Fox Royale. They're fucking awesome. And the reason they're awesome is because they invest in their band not just by spending time making TikToks. They invest in their band by booking shows and going on tour and doing it all themselves. And I fucking love that. And I don't see enough of that. I feel like a lot of artists and a lot of bands, while they will spend the time and the money and the effort in recording the music, the way they're promoting it is just solely online and on socials. Mm. And yeah, I know I sound like a fucking old-ass bitch, but there's just something inspiring about a band who will go fucking play shows and book their own tours, even if fucking nobody shows up some nights. Like, they're out there getting better at what they do, getting better playing together. And, I mean, even if they make five new fans that night, that's more rewarding, from my experience, that's more rewarding than the instant gratification of somebody commenting on a TikTok or an Instagram post.
Right.
So that's super fun and that's super inspiring. So yeah, I'm just kind of, I guess, trying to find artists like that and find projects like that inspire me too, not just to be a guy who has a studio, and I don't want to just be an engineer. Like, that's a lot of fucking fun.
Right. Being a guy who just owns a studio is just called living in Nashville.
Like, yeah, and you know, and then you start stressing out about like actual like work and real life shit, and like the, you know, trying to like pay your bills by your studio income, and like basing what projects you take on by, you know, like I said, I'm fortunate to where I kind of get to pick and choose.
Yeah, that's awesome.
When I'm not doing that, I get to go and be a 20-year-old in a band. And that's what pays the bills and allows me to just work on the shit that I'm excited about and that inspires me in the studio.
That's awesome. We live the exact opposite life.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to bring it down.
Yeah. No, it's not bringing it down at all. That's awesome. I have to produce music to pay the bills to do my fun band thing that doesn't make money.
Oh, that's fun. Yeah.
Yeah.
That is, yeah. It's sit, dude.
I get
separated at birth, bro.
Yeah. Well, I look forward to seeing your shrine after this. You know, your clarity shrine. I don't know how you do that. It's a very abstract cover.
Like I said, I have limited space. I don't know if I have room for the shrine, but yeah. That's fucking cool. That's a flex.
I appreciate
that. That's rad. I love it.
Okay. I could talk to you for 2 more hours about shit. I feel like I have so many questions about, because I know you, there's things, and we'll have to talk about it another time, because I would love to know about what from Valentine, we didn't even talk about the second record y'all did with Howard Benson.
Yeah.
But Tim, all these guys, like, I know things from their, and think about it if you can't remember, but things from their process have, like, rubbed off on how you produce, and that's so cool, and I would love to know all those things. But we're coming to the end of the time. We want to respect your time, so.
I appreciate that.
We have one last question.
We do have one question we ask every guest.
We do.
You didn't show me that button before. you just showed me the rim shot and the fucking laugh.
Yeah, that's on page 3 for a reason.
Yeah. Oh, you had to change pages,
yeah, there's several pages of sound.
Oh, shit.
Let me tell you about that. Well, surprise, surprise.
Oh, you're right. The yellow one moved. It's in a different spot now.
Completely different sound now.
Yeah.
But, no, we do have one question we ask every guest.
Every single one.
That reminded me, we didn't even talk about Legos. They're coming out with Jaws, the Jaws Lego set.
What?
Yeah.
Really?
I'm not.
You're 35. How old are you?
35.
Okay. Yeah. You're still peak,
like in that realm. Like, I mean, well, part of me deep down has always wanted, like, the big, like, Millennium Falcon Lego.
Did you grow up playing with Legos?
Oh,
though?
Yeah. But I never had the sets. I had just plastic bins full of
You know
of
what
loose
the sets
Legos.
Are now? The sets are now 18 and up. Like, yeah, I got a fucking Indiana Jones Temple of Doom that's the goriest and, like, kind of semi-racist, too. I think they pulled it from shelves because it was kind of offensive.
What? Was Short Round in it? Is that? Oh, no, he wasn't Temple
of
Doom.
Well, I mean, imagine,
right?
it's the whole scene where, like, what was the saying? It's when he pulls the guy's heart out. Yeah, what is he saying when he does that? I keep thinking Vimshnup, but no, that's how you remember the planets, thanks to Screech Powers. He taught me that.
I was thinking Klata Barakta.
This is a tremendous
not that.
Heart.
That's wrong.
So, tremendous heart, one of the best hearts there's ever been.
But
yeah,
whatever
he yells there, yeah, Kamehameha or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah, it's something like that. And so, yeah, like in the 80s, that was okay, I guess. But yeah, now I think they even pulled that from shelves. But those are the sets that they're putting out to get people like us in there.
Yeah.
And Jaws is the next one.
And they charge like $900 a pop.
What was it? I just got the Batcave, but it's the Batcave from Batman Returns. So it has Michelle Pfeiffer, Catwoman, fucking Danny DeVito, Penguin. It shows like $400 fucking dollars.
Oh my
God.
And
all the pieces are black. It's going to be the hardest fucking Lego set
I've
ever... It's
like a blank puzzle. Like, what are you supposed to do here?
It's like putting together a puzzle with everything upside down.
Oh, man.
Sorry. Jaws, Legos, go.
If you had to choose...
And you do.
Fuck.
Now, the important thing to note about this question is the answer must not come from here.
Oh, sorry. My part. For the audio-only listeners, it must come not from the head.
It must come.
He's pointing at his head. That's why
we're locked in a very small room. I'm nervous.
Yeah,
it must come from here.
Oh, okay. Thank God.
Again,
I thought you were gonna point lower than that.
If you're and this is a great time to mention, this is video. We know that there's cameras, but if you're listening to this like you're in 2015, all podcasts are video.
Like last
too.
Week.
Yeah, yeah, I know. All podcasts are video, so watch us on Spotify and YouTube. But he pointed to his heart.
True.
You can watch podcasts on Spotify?
You sure can. Welcome to the
Our
real
video's
world,
on there.
Nick.
Wow, I'm living in 2015, apparently.
Oh, yeah, you didn't know on Spotify you can watch it. Oh, sorry. On Spotify, you can watch us.
I'm an Apple Music guy, man.
Dude, I mean, supposedly it's better quality. I have too many playlists in Spotify at this point. I can't move on.
Opening Spotify is like... opening Facebook. I'm like, what am I supposed to do with all this? This is a fucking
too much slapped right in your face.
Yeah, Apple Music was the natural progression from iTunes and from my iPod era, so it just felt natural.
Yeah.
All right, that was fun, guys. Yeah. Oh, fuck.
You had to choose.
I thought I got out of it.
And you do.
No, now the important thing, what that means coming from your heart and not your head.
I'm so fucking stressed out right now.
Is I need an answer instantly.
Okay.
I don't want you to think about it.
Not even a bit.
I'm terrible.
I want the answer that's deep in your soul.
I'm terrible at lightning rounds.
This is a lightning.
It's one question lightning round.
Okay. Lightning 100 round.
Okay.
.com.
Yeah. But if you had to choose.
And you do.
And you do. What would you say is your favorite kind of turtle?
I only know one kind of turtle.
Say that now.
Turtle. The turtle. Raphael.
Turtle. I only know one kind of turtle. Turtle? I don't fucking know.
Sorry, I'm confused. Was your answer turtle?
Turtle?
Or was it Raphael? I love them both for different reasons.
Turtle. We've never gotten just turtle before.
Are there different kinds of turtles?
There's so many.
Yeah.
As we've learned.
Well, there's like the big ones that live like 400 years.
Those are tortoises.
Oh.
These are like species.
You know, sea turtle, snapping turtle,
soft-shell
box turtle, soft-shell.
Soft-shell turtle?
Yeah, it's a thing.
Wesley has put all the turtles on the
For your future reference.
That's
red-eared slider.
Turtles.
The classic Chinese soft-shell, as everyone knows.
Okay, I've heard of a box turtle. Okay. pond slider? That just sounds like a booger.
Bruh, you live in East Nashville, right?
I do, yeah.
You gotta know all the turtles, man. It's like, it's a pretentious area, East Nashville. It's gotta be about that niche turtle.
I was at Shelby the other day, and my dog met a turtle for the first time, but it was a little teeny, like, itty-bitty one.
Oh, yeah, I never asked you what kind of dog you have.
He's a 16-year-old Boston Terrier mix
16.
Named Dexter, yeah. He didn't see the turtle, but I did get a good picture of him next to it.
Well, 16, I mean, he's probably a little oblivious.
His eyesight's not awesome.
Yeah.
But
he's old, even for a boxer.
Boston Terrier?
Oh, I thought you said boxer mix. Oh, yeah,
he looks like a small boxer because he's brown and white and brindle.
Gotcha.
But he's a Boston mix, and okay. He's 16. He's a tour dog for a while.
That's
he's lived awesome. A lot of life. Yeah.
That's awesome.
Did you name him after Dexter?
I did.
Dude. Yes. Right.
I have a tattoo of him on my leg with bloody paw prints around him.
Dude.
Yeah.
That is the best place possible to end this podcast.
I'd say.
Yeah. Nick Wheeler, you're going on tour in the fall?
Yep. First show is August 11th in Tampa, and we're coming through Nashville on later that month. I want to say the 25th of August. We'll be at Municipal.
Dude, that's the day before my birthday.
I know.
Last night, my girlfriend... Weird. last night my girlfriend and I were talking about going to see the Goo Goo Dolls on the 25th.
But I did hear it's the same night as the Goo Goo Dolls. Yeah.
But you know what? Fuck the Goo Goo Dolls.
Wait, who are they here with?
I don't care.
Sick. I will say last time we played Nashville, we were at Ascend the same night that Matchbox 20 was at Bridgestone.
Oh, man.
And that show and the Goo Goo Dolls show, like, I would go to all of those. So
oh, yeah,
I'm almost like, can we move our show?
Yeah.
But
we'll talk about Matchbox off the air for a different reason, but I'm going to go to that show too.
Okay, are they playing one time or twice here?
They're playing once on July 3rd at Bridgestone.
Okay, I thought there was
a show.
And there
are still tickets
too,
available, and they have good.
I do want to go to that. I love the new record. But yeah, we're coming through August 25th with Newfound Glory. This first leg will be Starting Line and the Get Up Kids. Second leg, which will be like the western half of the U.S., will be Newfound Glory, Motion City Soundtrack, and the Get Up Kids.
Nice. Hell yeah.
Yeah.
Now, normally this is where I say, let all people know where they can find you, but I'm pretty sure people can find All American Rejects pretty easily.
So we're on
is there anything else you want to plug?
We're on all the things. I'm on one of the things. I only do Instagram because that's about all I have the attention span or the 40-year-old fucking geezer knowledge for.
I feel that.
I'm on Instagram, Nickolas Wheeler with a fucking K. There might be an underscore in there between the names. I don't fucking know.
I think it's a dot.
Is it a dot?
Maybe. I don't know. I feel like I looked it up earlier. But
it's all. It's one of the like the lower like punctuations. Oh, he's looking it up.
I'm looking it up. It's hard to find because I'm old too. Nickolas, spelled N-I-C-K-O-L-A-S.
Oh, you have a C and a K?
Underscore Wheeler,
W-H-E-L-E-R. Oh, it's an underscore. I'm completely wrong.
He's shown, Wesley's shown the screen. Thank you, Wesley.
There I am.
Nickolas Wheeler.
Yeah, and then just for fun, I have a studio page too. That's Wheelhouse Studio Nashville.
Hell yeah.
And yeah, that's all the studio geek shit gets funneled through that.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
All right. Well, I'm going to tell my girlfriend that we're not seeing Goo Goo Dolls. We're going to see the All-American Rejects.
Sorry.
Because fuck you. Is it Johnny Resnick?
Yeah.
Yeah, fuck you, Johnny Resnick. You've never been on our show.
And now he's joins the...
Dude, him and Don Henley are starting Don like Henley. The super villains yeah. team.
You officially have a list now. There's
you have enemies
teams.
Now.
Yeah. Super celebrity enemies. Yeah. But, oh wait, you do the ending.
Yeah.
That felt just like a good
yeah,
time
felt
to end.
Weird. So I do the outro, just like I do the intro.
Jesus Christ, do your job.
As always, guys, thanks for coming to hang out with us. You guys are awesome, and we'll see y'all next time.
I wake up every evening with a big smile on my face, and I never feel out of place. And you're still probably working at a 9-to-5 pace. I wonder how bad that tastes. When you see my face, hope it gives you hell, hope it gives you hell. When you walk my way, hope it gives you hell, hope it gives you hell. Now where's your picket fence, love?